Good morning, dear students. This day, I have come up to explain you all about microprocessor and microcontroller. To begin with, I would first of all like to introduce myself. I am Dr. M. Kalpana Devi, working as an assistant professor, Department of EEE, Government College of Engineering, Sengipatti, Thanjavur.
This slide shows the syllabus of the subject, microprocessors and microcontrollers. The first unit is all about 8085 microprocessor. The second unit contains the programming of 8085 microprocessor. The unit 3 is about 8051 microcontroller. The fourth unit contains the peripheral interfacing, followed by the last and the fifth, which is nothing but the microcontroller programming and applications. We will see each unit one by one. First of all, let us see the first unit. Take a look at the agenda of this day. Today, we are going to learn about hardware architecture, in details of 8085 microprocessor, functional building blocks of 8085 microprocessor, memory organization, I/O ports, data transfer concept, timing diagram, and interrupts. Let us see what is microprocessor.
Microprocessor is here. Semiconductor device manufactured by using LSI or VLSI technology. LSI means large scale integrated device, that is more than 1000 components are fabricated on the same IC chip, that is LSI technology. VLSI means very large scale integrated device, that is more than 10,000 components are fabricated on the same IC chip. That is VLSI technology. So, microprocessor is a semiconductor device manufactured by using LSI or VLSI technology. It includes three components. The first one is arithmetic logic unit, the second one register array, and third one is control circuits. So, this is the definition of microprocessor. Let's see the history of microprocessor. The first microprocessor was designed by Intel Corporation in 1971, which was the first 4-bit microprocessor called 4004. It has 2300 transistors using LSI technology. It could perform 4-bit simple arithmetic and logical operations. It is operated on 108 kHz. The total memory capacity of 4004 is 640 bytes. The next processor is 8008. It was introduced in the year of 1972. It contains 3500 transistors operated at 200 kHz clock cycle. The memory capacity is 16 kilobytes. The next one is 8080. Was introduced in the year of 1972. It contains 6000 transistors operated at 2 MHz clock cycle. The memory capacity of 8080 is 64 kilobytes. The next one is 8085 microprocessor. It was introduced in the year of 1976. It contains 6500 components. All components are fabricated on the same IC chip. It is operated at 5 MHz clock cycle. The total memory capacity of 8085 is 64 kilobytes. The first microprocessor, that is 4004, is a 4-bit processor, whereas the remaining 3 are 8-bit processors. The next one is 16-bit processor.
8086 is a 16-bit microprocessor.
It was introduced in the year of 1978. Here, 29,000 transistors are used. It is operated at 5 MHz clock cycle. The memory capacity of 8086 is 1 MB. The next one is 8088. Was introduced in the year of 1979. Here, 29,000 transistors are used. Operated at 5 MHz clock cycle. Here, 1 MB of memory was used. The next one is 8286, was introduced in the year of 1982. Here 134,000 components are fabricated on the same IC chip. It is operated at 8 MHz clock cycle. The total memory capacity of 80 to 86 is 16 MB. The next one is 32-bit microprocessor. 80386 was introduced in the year of 1985. So in this IC, 275,000 components are fabricated on a single IC chip. It is operated on 16 MHz clock cycle. The memory capacity of this IC is 4 GB. The next one is 80486. Was introduced in the year of 1989. 1.2 million components are used, operated at 25 MHz clock cycle. Memory capacity is 4 GB. The next processor is Pentium processor. Was introduced in the year of 1993. Here 3.1 million components are used, operated at 60 MHz clock cycle. The memory capacity is 4 GB. The next one is Pentium Pro processor, was introduced in the year of 1995. It uses 5.5 million components, operated at 150 MHz clock cycle. The total memory capacity of Pentium Pro processor is 64 GB.
So far, we discussed first generation to fourth generation microprocessor. That is, using PMOS technology, the first generation microprocessor, that is 4-bit processor, which was developed during the period of 1971 to 1973. Then, the N-channel metal oxide semiconductor, that is NMOS technology, developed 8-bit processor. This technology offered high density and faster speed than PMOS, which was developed between the year of 1974 to 1978, called second generation microprocessor. The third generation introduced 16-bit processor in the year of 1978 to 1980, based on high density metal oxide semiconductor, that is HMOS technology. Fourth generation, that is 1981 to 1995, all processors are fabricated using high density, high speed, complementary metal oxide semiconductor, that is HCMOS technology. 32-bit processors were developed. Now we are using fifth generation processors from 1995 to till date. The fifth generation introduced 64-bit microprocessors such as Pentium, Celeron and dual quad core processors working at a speed of 3.5 GHz. In 1997, Intel Pentium 2 processor was designed specifically to process video and graphics data. In 1999, Intel Celeron processor and Intel Pentium 3 processor were developed. In 2000, Intel Pentium 4 processor with the 64-bit data and 64 GB memory was developed. Various other companies such as Motorola, NEC, Siemens, Toshiba and Texas Instruments also manufactured processor chips. So this is about history of microprocessors.
Before going to the microprocessor, first we will study the basic definitions related to the microprocessor. The first definition is microcomputer. A computer is designed using microprocessor as its CPU. It is called microcomputer. Okay, a computer is designed using microprocessor as its CPU, that is called microcomputer. It has four components. The first one is microprocessor. So microprocessor act as central processing unit. The second one is memory. Third one is input devices. And fourth one is output devices. The next one is hardware. Hardware is nothing but the physical components of the computer are called hardware. Next one is program. Program is nothing but a set of instructions written for the computer to perform a specified task is called program. Okay, So, program is nothing but a set of instructions written for the computer to perform a specified task is called program. Okay. Next one is software. Software, that is a group of programs, are called software. Okay, a group of programs are called software. Then firmware. When software stores permanently in ROM, PROM and EPROM are called firmware. Okay, then ROM. ROM stands for RAM stands for read only memory. A memory that stores binary information permanently. So that is ROM. The information can be read from this memory but cannot be altered. Okay, that is RAM memory. The next one is RAM memory. RAM stands for random access memory. A memory that stores binary information during the operation of the computer. The information stored in this memory can be read and altered easily. That is RAM type memory. The next one is bit. The binary digits, zeros and ones are called bit. The next one is byte. Byte is nothing but it is a group of 8 bits. That is byte. Okay, nibble is nothing but a group of 4 bits is called nibble. So each byte contains 2 nibble. Okay, then next one is word. Word is a group of bits that the computer recognizes and processes at a time. That is word. Okay, next one is instruction. A command in binary that the computer recognizes and executes in order to accomplish a task is called instruction. Okay, a command in binary that the computer recognizes and executes in order to accomplish a task is called instruction. So, instruction made up of a single word or group of words. That is called instruction. Next one is peripherals. The input devices and output devices are connected to the microprocessor are called peripheral devices. Okay, so external devices are also called as peripheral devices. The next one is memory space. The entire set of memory location that a microprocessor can access is called as memory space. The entire set of memory location that a microprocessor can access is called memory space. Next one is memory writing. Entering information into the memory is called memory writing. Next one is memory reading. Memory reading means retrieving information from the memory is called memory reading. This is the last definition, tri-state logic. Tri-state means 3 logic states, logic 0, logic 1 and high impedance state. So this is the tri-state logic symbol. Here this is input line, this is output line, the third line called enable line. Here the tri-state logic depends on the enable line status. Whenever the enable line is active, that time the tri-state logic acts as inverter. Okay, if the enable line disables means that time the tri-state logic goes to high impedance state. See the truth table. Here enable line is active, so input is 0, output is 1. Here input is 1, the output is 0. Okay, so because the enable line is active. Suppose if the enable line is disable condition, okay, that time whatever may be the input value, here the tri-state logic goes to high impedance state. Okay, if 0 means here enable line, disable condition, so high impedance state. If the input is 1 but enable line is disabled, so it is a high impedance state. So what is high impedance state? High impedance state is nothing but there is no connection between input and output. That state is called as high impedance state.
The next topic is the general architecture of microprocessor based system. So this is the general architecture of microprocessor based system.
It consists of microprocessor, memory, input devices, output devices, I/O ports, and buses. Let's see the microprocessor. Already you know the definition of microprocessor. Microprocessor is a semiconductor device manufactured by using LSI or VLSI technology. It includes ALU, register array, and control circuits on a single chip. It is the central processing unit, operates as desired by the user. The user writes a sequence of instructions known as program. This program is stored in memory. The microprocessor fetches these instructions one by one from the memory and executes them. The input devices supply the data for the microprocessor. The result of computations are sent to the output devices. The microprocessor also controls the various devices of the entire system. So, these are the functions of the microprocessor. Let's see memory section. The memory section usually consists of semiconductor memories such as ROM, PROM and EPROM. Large microcomputers use magnetic memories such as cassette tapes or disk, etc. in addition with semiconductor memories. Memory section is used to store program data to be processed or result of processing. The next section is I/O devices. The input devices convert the input data into proper binary form. The typical input devices are keyboard, toggle switches, teletypewriter, analog to digital converter, etc. Then output devices. The output devices convert binary information from the microprocessor into useful form. Examples: printer, cassettes, compact disc, 7-segment LED display, cathode ray tube, etc. Then I/O ports. The input-output devices communicate to the microprocessor through an interface called I/O ports. Physically, the I/O ports consist of parallel D flip-flop, which pass data as decided by the CPU. Then, bus structure. Bus is a group of lines connecting the microprocessor and other component of the computer system. Bus is a communication path over which electrical signals are transmitted. One line is used for each bit to be transmitted. There are three types of buses: address bus, data bus, and control bus. Let's see address bus. The address used by the CPU to send the address of the memory location or I/O port which the microprocessor desires to access. The address is received by all the devices, but only the device that has been addressed responds. The address bus is unidirectional. The next one is data bus. The data bus is used to transfer data to and from the microprocessor. It is bidirectional. So, the data are transmitted between microprocessor and memory. Similarly, microprocessor and I/O devices. The third one called control bus. The control bus carries signal needed for synchronization and control of the entire system. Examples of control signals are read signal, write signal, hold, reset, etc. So, using these signals, the processor controls the entire operation of the system. So far we have discussed what is microprocessor, basic definitions related to microprocessor, and general architecture of microprocessor based system. Next, we will study the introduction to 8085 microprocessor. The Intel 8085 is an 8-bit microprocessor introduced by Intel in 1976. The 8085 is a conventional non-Newman design architecture based on the Intel 8080. It is a design by using NMOS technology. The features of 8085 microprocessors are: the Intel 8085 is a 8-bit microprocessor. It is a 40-pin IC chip dual-in-line package. Its clock speed is 3 to 5 MHz clock cycle. The Intel 8085 uses a single plus 5 volt DC supply for its operation. It uses 6200 to 6500 components. It provides on-chip clock generator. It has 16-bit address bus. So, 2 power 16 is nothing but 64. So, 64 kilobytes of memory location. Similarly, it has 8-bit data bus. 2 power 8 is nothing but 256. So, 256 ports can be accessed. It has 74 basic instructions. So, these are the features of 8085 microprocessor. Then, the next one is architecture of 8085 microprocessor. So, this is the architecture. The Intel 8085 microprocessor is a 40-pin IC chip. Already you know, dual-in-line package. It is a 8-bit general-purpose microprocessor capable of addressing 64 kilobyte of memory. It needs plus 5 volt power supply and can operate on 3 MHz clock cycle. The architecture consists of totally 13 blocks. The first one is arithmetic logic unit. So this is arithmetic logic unit. Second block accumulator. Third block is temporary register. Fourth block is flag flip-flop. Fifth one, general purpose register. Sixth one, program counter. Seventh one, stack pointer. Eighth block is increment or decrement register. Ninth one, address latch, address buffer and address data buffer. Tenth block is instruction register and decoder. 11th one is timing and control circuit. 12th block, interrupt control. Then last one is serial I/O control. So, this architecture consists of totally 13 blocks. We will see one by one. Let's see the first block, ALU, arithmetic logic unit. Arithmetic logic unit performs arithmetic and logical operations on 8-bit words. The arithmetic logic unit performs operations such as addition, subtraction, increment, decrement, and OR, XOR, complement, compare, and rotate operations on 8-bit words. So, this is the function of ALU, arithmetic logic unit. The second block is accumulator. Accumulator is a special 8-bit register. It is also called register A. It holds one of the data during ALU operation and it also receives the result of ALU operation. During execution of in and out instructions, data transfer takes place only between accumulator and I/O devices. So, these are the functions of accumulator. The third block is temporary register. It is an 8-bit register. It receives data from general purpose register and holds it for ALU and cannot be accessible to the programmer. Okay, so this is about temporary register data. Then fourth one is flag flip-flops. The flag register consists of 5 single-bit flip-flops. These flip-flops contain status information of the CPU and are known as condition code flags. They are carry flag, parity flag, auxiliary carry flag, zero flag and sign flag. So, this is the format of flag register. So, flag register is a 8-bit register. Out of 8-bit, 5 bits are used for flag purpose. The remaining 3 unused. That is D1, D3 and D5. These bits are not used. So, D0 bit is used for to store the carry value. D2 bit is used for to store the parity value. D4 bit is used for to store the auxiliary carry value. D6 bit is used for to store the 0 value. Then D7th bit shows the sign whether the answer is positive or negative. So these flags are set or reset according to the result of ALU operation. See the carry flag. Carry is set when an arithmetic operation generates a carry out, otherwise it is reset. Then parity. If parity is equal to 1, if the result of ALU operation has an even number of 1s in the accumulator. Otherwise, it is reset. If it is odd, means it is a reset. Then auxiliary carry flag. This is similar to carry flag. If auxiliary carry is set, if there is a carry from D3 to D4 bit. If it is a reset, means there is no carry from D3 to D4 bit. Then next one is zero flag. Zero flag is set if a result of accumulator is 0. Otherwise, the bit is reset. Then the last bit, that is sign flag. If sign bit value is equal to 1, it indicates the accumulator value is negative number. Okay. Similarly, S value is equal to 0, it indicates the accumulator result is positive value. So the flags are set or reset according to the result of ALU operation. The next block is general purpose register. The 8085 has 6 general purpose registers. They are B, C, D, E, H and L. These registers are 8-bit registers. These registers can also be used in pairs. Only combinations BC, DE, HL. Two additional registers called W and Z. These registers are used to hold 8-bit data during execution of some instruction. It is not accessible by the programmer. The next one is program counter. Program counter is a 16-bit register used as memory pointer. It holds the address of the memory location where the next instruction to be executed is stored. During the execution of instruction, the content of PC is incremented or modified. At the end of the execution of the instruction, the PC points to the memory location where the next instruction is available. So this is the function of program counter. The next block is stack pointer. Stack pointer is also a 16-bit register used as memory pointer. It controls a portion of RAM used as last in first out memory. This area of RAM is defined as stack. The stack pointer holds the address of the top of the stack. The content of the stack pointer is decremented or incremented whenever the information is stored or retrieved from the memory or from the stack. The next one is increment or decrement register. The increment-decrement register can add 1 or subtract 1 from the content of any of the 16-bit register. The next block is address latch, address buffer and address data buffer. The address latch select the address from any one of the 16-bit register. The selected address is loaded into the address buffer and address data buffer. The output of these buffers drives the buses. The memory and I/O devices are connected to these buses. In this way, the CPU can send the data to the memory and I/O devices. The next block is instruction register and decoder. The instruction fetched from memory is loaded into the instruction register. The decoder interprets these instructions, decides the sequence of events and produces proper and timing control signals. The next block is timing and control signal. The timing and control signal synchronize all operations of the microprocessor with the system clock. It includes an oscillator and a controller sequencer circuit. The oscillator circuit generates the two-phase clock signal that synchronizes all registers. The controller sequencer generates a sequence of enabled signals. The next block is interrupts. The interrupt control unit will accept interrupt signal from external devices. The 8085 has 5 interrupts. They are TRAM, RST7.5, RST6.5, RST5.5 and INTR. When interrupt signal occurs, the processor suspends its normal activities and controller is transferred to the interrupt service routine. When this routine over, then the processor returns to the main program automatically. If two or more interrupts occurs at the same time, the 8085 will service them in the order of priority. So, TRAP is the highest priority followed by RST7.5, RST6.5, RST5.5 and INTR. INTR is the lowest priority. One more signal, INTA, that is interrupt acknowledgement signal. If the processor, after accepting interrupt request signal, immediately the processor send an acknowledgement signal to the corresponding device. So, only one output signal, that is INTA signal, interrupt acknowledgement signal. The next block is serial I/O control. The serial data are transmitted through SID and SOD lines. The actual data transfer is done by software using SIM and RIM instructions. SID stands for serial in data and SOD stands for serial out data. So this is about architecture of 8085 microprocessor.
So, we have seen the definition of microprocessor, its history and some basic definitions related to it. Then, we have seen the general architecture of microprocessor based system. And at last, we have also seen the architecture of 8085 microprocessor in detail.
So, this is the pin diagram of 8085 microprocessor. Last video, we discussed the architecture of 8085 microprocessor. So, already you know, 8085 microprocessor is a 40-pin IC chip, dual in LAN package. So, dual in LAN package means it is rectangular housing with the two parallel electrical connected pins, that is called DIP IC chip. Okay, see the diagram here. First 20 pins are connected on one side, another 20 pins are connected on another side. So this is DIP IC with the rectangular shape. So this is DIP IC. Okay, in 8085 microprocessor, the first two pins are X1 and X2. The 8085 has a built-in oscillator circuit to generate the clock signal. It has all the required circuits except the crystal. So, a crystal oscillator circuit is connected between pin number 1 and 2 to generate the clock signal. The clock frequency is of the original frequency. That is the function of pin number 1 and 2. So, crystal oscillator is connected between pin number 1 and 2 to generate the clock signal. So, that is the use of pin number 1 and 2. Okay, then see the pin number 3, it is reset out signal. When the CPU is reset, to send out a reset out signal to the peripheral indicating that the CPU is reset. This output signal is used to reset the peripheral devices. That is the use of reset out signal. Okay, then pin number 4 and 5. 4 and 5 is used for data transmission serially. So using pin number 4 and 5, the data are transmitted serially. The SOD line stands for serial out data. SID line stands for serial in data. Okay, through this pins, the data are transmitted serially with the help of two instructions. One as SIM instruction, another one RIM instruction. Okay, the SOD line is set or reset as specified by the SIM instruction. When RIM instruction is executed, that time the data on the SID line is transmitted to the accumulator bit 7. That is the function of SOD and SID. Pin number 6 to 10 called interrupt pins. The 8085 has 5 interrupt signals. They are TRAP, RST7.5, RST6.5, RST5.5 and INTR. These interrupt signals are connected through pin number 6 to 10. Okay, if any one of the interrupt occurs, that time the processor will suspend its normal activity and control is transferred to the interrupt service routine. Okay, if more than one interrupt occurs, means that time the 8085 will service them in the order of priority. So TRAP is the highest priority, followed by RST7.5, RST6.5, RST5.5 and INTR. INTR is the lowest priority. So this is about pin details of interrupt signals. Pin number 11 is the interrupt acknowledgement signal. When the CPU accepts interrupt request signal, immediately the CPU send out a interrupt acknowledgement signal to the corresponding device through pin number 11. So this signal is used to activate the interrupt controller or interrupt port. That is the use of INTA. Then next pins, that is AD0 to AD7, that is pin number 12 to 19, called multiplexer address data lines. These lines are used for two different purposes. The first one is low order 8-bit memory or IO address transmission. Then the same line is used for bidirectional data transmission, that is to send or receive data through these lines. So it is called as multiplexer address data lines. The 20th pin is nothing but ground signal. Pin number 21 to 28, the signal lines, that is A8 to A15, form the high order address bus and carry the most significant 8 bits of the memory or 8 bits of the IO address. The high order address bus is unidirectional. Okay. Then pin number 30, ALE, address latch enable signal. Okay, this signal is used to load the address into on-chip latch of the peripherals. Once the address is loaded into the peripheral, then the low-order address bus can be used as data bus. Then pin number 31, that is write signal. This signal indicates the data on the data bus is to be written into the selected memory location or I/O device. Then pin number 32, that is read signal. This signal indicates that the selected memory location or IO device is to be read and the content is to be placed on the data bus. That is the function of read RD signal or read signal. Pin number 29 and 33, that is S0 and S1. Signals indicate the type of operation performed by the microprocessor, such as opcode fetch, memory read, memory write, I/O read, I/O write, halt, etc. Then pin number 34, that is I/O bar, M bar. Okay, this signal indicates whether the operation relates to I/O operation or memory operation. If the signal goes high, it relates I/O operation. When the signal goes low, it relates memory operation. Pin number 35 is the ready signal. This is input line used to indicate the CPU whether the peripheral is ready to send or receive data during read or write operation. If the line is low, the processor will wait for ready line to go high. The next signal is reset in, that is pin number 36. When the signal goes low, the CPU resets the program counter and all buses are tri-stated. Then it sends out reset out signal to the peripheral devices. That is the function of reset in signal. Pin number 37 is the clock out signal. The clock signal goes to peripheral and synchronizes the operation with the CPU. That is the function of clock out signal. Then pin number 38 and 39. These signals used by DMA controller. DMA controller is requesting the use of address bus and data bus through hold request signal. Okay, when the signal goes high, the CPU completes its current operation and releases the buses for DMA use. HLDA is the acknowledgement signal. This is the output signal, indicates the peripheral that the CPU has received the hold request and that it will releases the buses in the next clock cycle. That is the use of a hold acknowledgement signal. Okay, then this is the last pin, that is pin number 40. 40 is nothing but it is connected to plus 5 volt power supply. So this is about pin diagram of 8085 microprocessor. The next topic is memory organization of 8085 microprocessor. The 8085 microprocessor has 64 kilobyte of addressable memory space and allocating this address space for RAM device and EEPROM device depends upon the application. Okay, some system may require large memory space but some system requires less memory space, and in this case the entire memory is not utilized in case of 8085 microprocessor. In EEPROM is used as program memory and RAM is used as data memory. When EEPROM and RAM are used, the total 64 kilobyte of address space is shared between them. Okay, first let us see the memory mapping. Memory mapping is defined as assignment of addresses to memory registers in various memory chips like RAM, ROM and EEPROM devices etc. of a system. Okay, in a system based on 8085 microprocessor, the entire memory map can range from 0000 to FFFF, that is 64 kilobyte of memory space. The system may not utilize the entire range of address. The memory map of the system will show the assignment of addresses to memory chips used in the system. Okay, this is the diagram. The number of address lines of the microprocessor unit determines its memory capacity. The 8085 microprocessor unit has 16 address lines and it is capable of addressing 64 kilobyte of memory space. That is 2 power 16 is nothing but 64 kilobyte of memory registers. The entire memory address can range from 0000 to FFFF in hexadecimal. The memory address provides the location of various devices in the system. The 8085 microprocessor can access 64 kilobyte of memory, but it is not necessary to use full 64 kilobyte of address space. So the total memory size depends upon the various applications. Okay, the next one is I/O mapping. Okay, I/O mapping is defined as the assignment of addresses to various I/O devices used in the system. Normally, the microprocessor will be connected to the memory as well as I/O device. There are two methods by which the microprocessor can identify and communicate with the I/O device. These methods are known as memory mapped I/O and I/O mapped I/O. Okay, memory mapped I/O and I/O device is treated as memory location. Okay, the microprocessor uses 16-bit address to identify I/O device. The 8085 microprocessor, the 64 kilobyte of memory map is shared between memory and I/O device. The address assigned for I/O device cannot be used memory register. This form of connecting I/O device to the microprocessor is known as memory mapped I/O. Okay, the memory related instructions are such as STA, LDA, move register to memory, or move memory to registers, are used to data transfer between microprocessor and I/O devices. Okay, in the above diagram, the address are allotted to the EEPROM. Okay, that is the lowest 8 kilobytes. The lowest 8 kilobytes address are allotted for EEPROM. The lowest 48 kilobyte of address is allotted for RAM. The next highest 2 kilobyte address are allotted to the I/O port, and remaining 6 kilobyte addresses are not used, that is unused. Okay, here the advantages of memory mapped I/O are it provides more input and output ports. Okay, and also the speed of operation is also high. Powerful instructions are used to access I/O devices, so no special instructions are needed for that. Okay, these are the advantages of memory mapped I/O. Here disadvantages are length of the program is increased interface hardware, then limited number of I/O ports connected, less memory requirements. Okay, so these are the disadvantages of memory mapped I/O. Okay, then the next one is I/O mapped I/O. So in this method, the I/O devices are treated separately from memory. The microprocessor uses 8-bit address to identify two I/O devices. That is 2 power 8 is nothing but 256 I/O devices can be connected to the microprocessor. So the address on the address bus may refer to the either memory location or I/O device. Okay, to identify the device address, the microprocessor issue a signal on the I/O bar M-bar signal. If the line is high, the address is meant for I/O device, otherwise it is for memory. The input and output device are differentiated by the control signals, that is I/O read and I/O write signal. Okay, so in this method, the I/O address range from 00 to FF. Okay, so totally 64 kilobyte of address space for I/O mapped I/O is shown here. The 8085 microprocessor has two instruction. One is in instruction, another one out instruction. It can be used for data transfer between I/O device and the processor. Okay, so here the advantages are simple program, memory address as not affected by I/O, then more space for memory. So these are the advantages of I/O mapped I/O. Then disadvantages are less powerful, less flexible than memory mapped I/O. Then two additional control lines are needed for issuing read and write signal. So these are the disadvantages of I/O mapped I/O.
Then comparison between memory mapped I/O and I/O mapped I/O. Okay, see the first difference, device address. In case of memory mapped I/O, the memory address is 16 bits, whereas I/O address is 8 bits. Okay, then second difference, control signal for input and output. Okay, in case of memory mapped I/O, either memory read signal or memory write signal are used. In case of I/O mapped I/O, I/O read signal and I/O write signal are used. Third one is instruction available. Here, all memory related instructions such as LDA, SDA, MOVE M, R, ADD M, these instructions under memory mapped IO. Whereas in case of IO mapped IO, only two instructions, the one is in instruction, the second one is out instruction. Okay, the fourth one is data transfer. Here in memory mapped IO, the data is transferred between any register and IO. In case of IO mapped IO, only between input output devices and accumulator. Okay, that is input devices to accumulator or accumulator to output devices. That is IO mapped IO. Okay, then fifth point, maximum number of IO devices. Okay, here memory map, 64 kilobyte of memory space is a shared between IO and system memory. In case of IO mapped IO, the IO mapping is independent of memory map. So 256 IO device can be connected to the microprocessor. Okay, so that is IO mapped IO. Then seventh one, hardware requirements. Here in memory mapped IO, more hardware is needed to decode 16-bit address, whereas here less hardware is needed to decode 8-bit address. Okay, then other features are here arithmetic and logical operation can be directly performed with IO data, whereas in case of IO mapped IO, it is not possible. So these are the difference between memory mapped IO and IO mapped IO.
Extra topic, IO ports and data transfer concept. Let's see IO ports. Usually, the microprocessor communicates with the input and output devices through an interface called input or output port. Physically, IO ports consist of parallel D flip-flop which pass data as desired by the CPU. Okay. Let's see data transfer concept. In a typical microcomputer, data transfer may take place between any two of the following devices, microprocessor memory and I/O device. Data between microprocessor memory and I/O device may be referred by programmed data transfer and second one is direct memory access transfer. In programmed data transfer, a software routine in the memory requests the device for data transfer to or from the microprocessor. This method is used when a relatively small amount of data is transferred with I/O device. The second one is DMA, that is direct memory access, is used when a large block of data is to be transferred between memory and I/O device. In this method of data transfer, the microprocessor is forced to hold on by the input device until the data transfer between the device and the memory is complete. Programmed data transfer can further classify into three types: synchronous data transfer scheme, asynchronous data transfer scheme, interrupt driven data transfer scheme. All this transfer require a combination of software and hardware for the implementation. Let's see one by one. Synchronous data transfer scheme. This is the simplest of all data transfer scheme. It may be used when the I/O device and the microprocessor match its speed. Whenever the data transfer is to be made from or to the device, the user program may issue suitable instruction addressing the device. At the end of the execution of the instruction, the data transfer have been completed. So this is about synchronous data transfer. See the flowchart, synchronous data transfer. So first request the device for ready operation. During that time, perform any other task until the device is ready. Then after that, issue I/O instructions, input or output instructions. So this is the flowchart of synchronous data transfer. Okay. Let's see the second method, asynchronous data transfer.
Asynchronous data transfer scheme is used when the speed of the I/O device does not match with that of microprocessor. In this scheme, the microprocessor first issue a get ready signal command to the device. Then the microprocessor waits until the device get ready. When the device is ready, it provides a ready signal to the microprocessor. Then the microprocessor issue data transfer instructions. Asynchronous data transfer is known as handshaking. So this is the flowchart of asynchronous data transfer. In asynchronous data transfer, the processor continuously checks whether the device is ready or not. Hence, its time is wasted. So this is the disadvantage of asynchronous data transfer. Okay, here one more example, that is ADC is interfaced to the microprocessor through an I/O port. Whenever the microprocessor acquires data from ADC, it issues SC signal, that is a start of conversion signal to ADC. Then the ADC start the conversion process. Then during the period of conversion, the ADC keep the EOC, that is end of conversion line, low. When the conversion is over, the ADC will place the data on the data bus and makes EOC line high. After issuing the start of conversion signal, the microprocessor checks the EOC line whether it is high. When EOC is asserted high, the microprocessor issues in instruction and data transfer to the microprocessor. So this is best example for asynchronous data transfer. The next one is interrupt driven data transfer. This method of data transfer is used for interfacing relatively slow devices to the microprocessor. Examples are paper tape punch, character printer, etc. When the processor requires data during the execution of a program, it indicates the I/O device and continues to execute the subsequent instruction in the program. When the I/O device is ready, it informs the processor through an interrupt line. When the interrupt is requested, the processor completes the instruction it was executing. Then it saves the content to the program counter on the stack and branches to the specific occasion in the memory. The processor now begins the execution of the subroutine from the branch address onwards. This subroutine saves the status of the processor on the stack and then performs the data transfer using I/O or other data transfer instructions. On completing the data transfer, the processor status is restored, and the processor returns to the main program. So this is the flowchart for interrupt-driven data transfer. The next type is DMA request. Usually, data is transferred between memory and external device through the accumulator. When bulk data transfer is to be made, routing each data byte through the accumulator is a time-consuming operation. In such a case, data transfer can be made rapidly by DMA without involving the accumulator. So without CPU, the data transfer takes place between memory and I/O devices. Okay. So without CPU, the data transfer takes place between memory and I/O devices. That is called DMA. Okay. There are two types of DMA. One is burst mode, another one cycle stream. Burst DMA transfer data
at the highest speed is possible, whereas a cycle scaling method is used to transfer one or two bytes at a time. See the first type, burst mode of data transfer, DMA. So this is the most common type DMA used with the microprocessor. When a block of data is ready for transfer, the DMA controller sends a hold request signal to the 8085 microprocessor. Okay. Then the completion of the processor completes its current cycle, then it send out a hold acknowledgement signal to the DMA and tri-state its buses. Then the DMA controller takes control of the buses. It provides the necessary address and control signals required for the proper operation of memory and I/O devices and completes the DMA transfer data. When data transfer is over, then the hold request is removed and HLDA becomes low. Okay, then the microprocessor takes control of buses and resumes its normal operation. So this is DMA flowchart. So first send the hold request, then send the HLDA signal, then send the address, then send the data, whether data completes or not. If not, means again do the same process. If operation over, means terminate the DMA operation. So this is the burst mode DMA flowchart diagram. The second one, that is cycle stealing. Cycle stealing transfer is used when there is a time delay between the transfer of two successive bytes or byte pairs. In this method, only one or two bytes are transferred at a time. This transfer is done between machine cycle of the processor. When the device is ready with the data, it requests the processor for DMA cycle. When the request is granted, the device transfers one or two bytes of data and then withdraws its hold request. After some time, when the device is ready for data transfer, it repeats the above process. So this is about data transfer concept of 8085 microprocessor. Let's see the next topic, timing diagram of 8085 microprocessor. A graphical representation of the instruction execution in steps with respect to the time is called timing diagram. The timing diagram provides information about various conditions of the signals while a machine cycle is executed. Let's see one by one. First, instruction cycle. An instruction cycle is defined as the time required for the microprocessor to fetch all the required parts of an instruction and execute that instruction. So this is the definition of instruction cycle. The next one is machine cycle. A machine cycle is defined as the time required to transfer data to or from the memory or I/O ports. The 8085 has 7 types of machine cycle. The first one is opcode fetch machine cycle. Second one, memory read machine cycle. Third one is memory write machine cycle. Fourth one, I/O read machine cycle. Fifth one, I/O write machine cycle. Sixth one, interrupt acknowledgement machine cycle. And last one is bus idle machine cycle. Okay, so here three status signals and control signals are used. The status signals are I/O bar M bar, S1 and S0. Then three control signals are read, write and INTA. So depends upon status and control signals, the machine cycle will be operated. The next one is T-state. Machine cycles are further divided into T-states. A T-state is defined as the interval between the successive falling edge of the clock pulses, that is one clock period is called T-state. So this is the definition of T-state. Okay. Next one, fetch cycle. Here two operations, So during a fixed cycle, the following operations are performed. The first one is the address of the next instruction is sent to the memory. Then second one, the instruction code is received from the memory. Okay, so these two operations under fetch cycle. Okay, so see here, the address of the next instruction is available in the program counter. The microprocessor transfer the content of PC to the address register. Then from there, it is transferred through the address and address data bus to the memory unit. In the memory unit, the address is decoded and address memory location is accessed. Okay, then the opcode byte from that location is transferred through the data bus into the instruction register IER. So these are the operations of fetch cycle. Okay, next one is execute cycle. Okay, here during execute cycle, the following operations are performed. The first function is the fetch instruction is decoded. Then if the operand is in memory, it is also fetched. Then the instruction is executed. So these are the operations of fetch cycle and execute cycle. Let's see the timing diagram of opcode fetch machine cycle. In all instruction, the first machine cycle is opcode fetch machine cycle. If this cycle fetches instructions from the memory to the instruction register of the microprocessor. So this is the timing diagram of opcode fetch machine cycle. Here for opcode fetch machine cycle, it names four T states: T1, T2, T3 and T4. Okay, here these signals are used. One is clock signal, then AD0 to AD7. These lines called address data lines, multiplexer address data lines. A8 to A15 address lines, ALE address latch enabled signal. Then this is read signal. Here IO bar M bar, S0 and S1. Okay, status signals are used. Okay. During T1 state, the content of the program counter is placed in the address bus. Okay, so here low order address is placed in the AD0 to AD7 lines and high order address is placed in the A8 to A15 lines during T1 state. The ALE signal is used to indicate the multiplexer AD0 to AD7 lines. Okay, the time taken by the processor to execute the opcode fetch cycle is 4 T states. The first three states, three T states are used for fetching operation, the opcode from the memory, and the remaining T state, that is T4, is used for internal instruction decoding and execution by the processor. Okay, here IO bar M bar signal is used to identify the memory and IO devices. Then S0 and S1 are also changed to the level indicator, that is processor state. Okay, so this cross signal indicates changes from one state to another state. Then during T2 stage, at the beginning of T2, the state of the microprocessor send the control signal, that is read signal, to enable memory and increment the program counter by 1. Okay. The content, that is D7 to D6, the content of the selected memory location are loaded, on the address data bus. Okay, address data bus. Okay. Then during T3, the microprocessor transfer the opcode of the address or data bus to the instruction register IR. Okay, then during T4 stage, the microprocessor decodes these instructions and that is fetching operation. Okay, so this is about timing diagram of opcode fetch machine cycle. The next one is memory read machine cycle. The memory read machine cycle is executed by the processor to read a data byte from the memory. For example, MVI B, 05. Okay, so this is the memory type instruction. So here the memory is read the data. Processor read the data, then that value is available in memory that is loaded into B register. So that is the function of MVI B, 05. Okay, so that timing diagram for the memory read machine cycle is shown here. Here it names three T states, T1, T2 and T3. So during T1, the microprocessor places the content of the program counter on 16-bit address bus. Then ALE signal goes high, and at the middle of T1 state, ALE signal goes low. Okay, once the address is latched into peripherals, then the ALE signal goes low. Then the microprocessor identifies the nature of the machine cycle by using status signals. Okay, status signals. For memory read machine cycle, here IO bar M bar is equal to 0, S1 equal to 1, S0 equal to 0. Okay, so this indicates memory read machine cycle. During T2 state, at the beginning of T2 state, the read signal line goes to low to enable read operation. Okay, so during T2 and T3, the processor read the information from the buses. Okay, then the content of data from the selected memory location are placed on address data bus. Okay, so then during T3 state, the data loaded on the address data bus is moved to the microprocessor. In the middle of T3, the control signal, that is RD signal, goes high and disable the memory read operation. So when the read signal goes low, that time the processor read the information from the address data bus. Okay, once the address, once the information are read, then thereafter the read signal goes high. So this is about timing diagram of memory read machine cycle. The next one is memory write machine cycle. The memory write machine cycle is executed by the processor to write a data byte in memory location. So the processor takes three T states, T1, T2 and T3. The first machine cycle is an opcode fetch machine cycle. The second machine cycle is memory write machine cycle. So it is used for transferring content of accumulator to the memory location. So here for memory write machine cycle, it needs three T states. So during T1, the processor places the 16-bit address in AD0 to AD7 and A8 to A15 lines. Then ALE signal goes high. Okay, after the address is latched into peripherals, the ALE signal goes low. The signal is used to latch the address bits into the memory. That is the purpose of ALE signal. The microprocessor identifies the nature of the machine cycle by using this signal. Okay. For memory write machine cycle, the IO bar M bar signal is equal to 0. Okay. Then S1 is equal to 0, S0 equal to 1. So this is write operation. So S1 equal to 0, S0 equal to 1. During T2 stage, at the beginning of T2, the write signal goes low. Okay. So see here, the data is loaded during T2 and T3 using AD0 to AD7 lines. So once the data is loaded, that time the write signal goes low, read the value
Then after that, after reading, then the signal goes into high. So this is about memory write machine cycle. Okay, so during T3, the data on the data bus is transferred to the specified memory location. In the middle of T state, the control signal writes, control signal is nothing but a write signal goes high and disable the memory. Okay, so this is about memory write machine cycle of 8085 microprocessor. The next one is timing diagram of I/O read machine cycle. I/O read machine cycle is similar to memory read machine cycle. Here only two instructions, I/O instructions. One is in instruction, another one out instructions. Okay, this instruction requires two machine cycle. The first one is opcode fetch machine cycle. The second one is memory read machine cycle. It is used to contain the port address is transferred to the microprocessor in case of in port. Okay, so here during T1 state, the processor places the address of the I/O device on the address bus. Actually, I/O address size is 8 bit. Okay, so the processor load the 8 bit address AD0 to AD7 as well as A8 to A15. Okay, once the address is loaded, then the ALE signal goes high. At the middle of T1 state, it goes low. Okay, this signal is used to latch the address of the I/O device. The microprocessor identifies the nature of the machine cycle by using status signal. Then for I/O read machine cycle, I/O bar M bar is equal to 1, S0 value is active, S1 is also active. Okay, S0 equal to 1, S1 equal to, S1 equal to 1 and S0 equal to 0. During T2 stage, at the beginning of T2, the read line goes low to enable the read operation. Okay. So, the content of the I/O device are placed on the address data bus, that is AD0 to AD7. Once the data is placed on AD0 to AD7, the read signal goes low, read the information during T2 and T3 state. During T3 stage, the data on the address data bus is transferred to the microprocessor and is copied into the next one is timing diagram of I/O read machine cycle. There are two instructions available. One is in instruction, another one out instructions. In any instruction has 2 bytes long. The second byte gives the port number or port address. The data in the specified address is to be read. Hence, in instruction requires 3 machine cycles. The first machine cycle is always opcode fetch machine cycle. The second machine cycle is the memory read machine cycle. So, this is followed by third machine cycle, that is, which is an I/O read cycle. Okay, the I/O read machine cycle is similar to memory read machine cycle with a few changes. At the beginning of the machine cycle, the microprocessor issues status signals as follows. Here, I/O bar M bar is equal to 1, S1 equal to 1, S0 equal to 0. The I/O bar M bar line is high, indicating that the address sent out is for an I/O device. As the address of the I/O device is only 1 byte long, the address is duplicated on the address and address data bus. At the beginning of T1, the address of the I/O device is placed on the address and address data bus. Okay, the microprocessor also issues the ALE signal to latch the address of the I/O device into address latch for I/O device. At the beginning of T2, the read signal line goes to low and the content of the I/O device is placed on the address data bus. In the middle of T3, the read line goes high and disables the I/O device.
From driving the data bus during T3 state, the content of the data bus is copied into the accumulator. The end of T3 state, the end of the I/O or machine cycle. So this is about timing diagram of I/O read machine cycle. The next one is I/O write machine cycle. Timing diagram of I/O write machine cycle. Here it needs three T states. It is similar to I/O memory write machine cycle. For example, here out 40. Okay, out is nothing but out instructions. 40 indicates port address. So for that, it needs three machine cycles. First machine cycle is the opcode fetch machine cycle. The next one is memory read machine cycle. The last one is I/O write machine cycle. Okay, here see the status signals for I/O bar M bar equal to 0, S1 equal to 0, S0 equal to 1. In T1, 16-bit address is placed on the ALE, 16-bit address is placed on the address bus and data bus. The address is latched into the ALE signal into memory address. In T2, the data to be sent out of the memory is placed on the address data bus and write signal is made low to enable the write operation. In T3, the content of the data bus is copied into the address memory location. In the middle of T3, the write signal goes high. The end of T3, the end of the memory write machine cycle. So this is about memory write machine cycle. In case of I/O write machine cycle, this is similar to memory write machine cycle. Here only changes I/O bar M bar signal is equal to 1, S1 equal to 0 and S0 equal to 1. I/O bar M bar line is high, indicating that the address sent out is for I/O device. Okay, as the port address is a single byte number, so it is a duplicated in address and address data buses. The ALE signal issued in T1 state latches the port address into the I/O latch. In T2, the content of the accumulator is placed on the address data bus and write line is made low to enable the write operation. In T3 state, the content of data bus is copied into the specified port. In middle of T3, the write signal goes high. The end of T3 state is end of the I/O write machine cycle. So this is about timing diagram of 8085 microprocessor. The next topic is types of interrupts. In the 8085 has 5 interrupt requests. They are TRAM, RST7.5, RST6.5, RST5.5 and INTR. Okay, so each interrupt has a priority level. TRAM is the highest priority, followed by RST7.5, RST6.5, RST5.5 and INTR. So INTR is the lowest priority. Okay, so these interrupts are classified into two types. One is hardware interrupts, another one software interrupts. The hardware interrupts are TRAM, RST7.5, RST6.5, RST5.5 and INTR. Okay, TRAM has the vector addresses 0024, RST7.5, 0030C, RST6.5, 0034, RST5.5, 0022C, INTR has no vectored address. So these are the priority level of interrupts, hardware interrupt. So TRAP is the highest priority, INTR is the lowest priority. Similarly, software interrupts are RST0, RST1, RST2, RST3, RST4, RST5, RST6 and RST7. So totally 8 software interrupts are available in 8085 microprocessor. Here vector address also given.
for RST 0 0 0 0 0, RST 1 0 0 0 8, similarly 2 0 0 1 0, this is 1 8 2 0 2 8 3 0 3 8, like that each interrupt has a separate vector address. Okay, then the hardware interrupts are classified into two types, one as vectored interrupt, another one non-vectored interrupt. Okay, vectored interrupt means trap RST 7.5, RST 6.5, RST 5.5 are called vectored interrupt when interrupt request come through these input control automatically transfer to specific memory locations where the starting address of the service subroutine are stored. Okay, the interrupt and the vector locations are given above in the order of decreasing priority. Okay, here the first vectored interrupt is TRAP. TRAP is a non-maskable interrupt. See here, vectored interrupt again classified into two types. One is maskable interrupt, another one non-maskable interrupt. So, TRAP is the non-maskable interrupt. It has the highest priority. It need not be enabled and it cannot be disabled. Okay, that is non-maskable interrupt. Okay, clear? So, TRAP is a non-maskable interrupt. It has the highest priority. It need not to be enabled and cannot be disabled. When this interrupt is triggered, the program control is transferred to the memory location, that is 0024. So 0024 is the vector address of TRAP without any external hardware or EI instruction. Okay, so TRAP is generally used for critical events such as power failure, parity errors, then emergency a shutoff, etc. So for this situation, TRAP instruction is executed. Okay, the next one is maskable interrupt. An interrupt that can be disabled by the system is called maskable interrupt. Okay, here maskable interrupt signals are RST 7.5, RST 6.5, and RST 5.5. so these three interrupts are maskable interrupts. These interrupt can be masked individually by SIM instruction or can be totally disabled by DI instruction. See the SIM instruction. Here the SIM stands for set interrupt mask. It operates on accumulator content. To use the SIM instruction, a byte is formed with a bit pattern. Here, this is the bit pattern of SIM instruction. This byte is loaded into the accumulator and the SIM instruction is executed. Okay, so the instruction transfer the content of accumulator to the appropriate location here given. Okay, as per the content of the bit pattern, the interrupt are enabled or masked. The bit pattern loaded into the accumulator are explained below. Okay, see M7.5. Okay, so M7.5 is nothing but RST 7.5 mask. M6.5 is nothing but RST 6.5 mask. M5.5 is nothing but RST 5.5 mask. So these three bits are masking bits of RST 7.5, 6.5 and 5.5. So they are used to set or reset the masking flip-flop. So for that purpose, these three bits are used, that is B0, B1 and B2. Okay, then MSE. So MSE is nothing but mask set enable. Okay, so if the bit is high, the masking bit reach the masking flip-flop. Okay, so if B3 value is equal to 1, that means the masking bit reach the masking flip-flop. Okay, the next one is RST 7.5. okay, this bit goes to the RST 7.5 flip-flop. When high, this bit clears a bending of RST 7.5 interrupt. Okay, then SOE and SOD. Okay, these two are used for serial communication. So, using these two bits, the data are transmitted serially. So, for that purpose, these two bits are used. So, one is serial out data, another one enable serial data. If the bit value is equal to 1, then it enables the serial operation. Okay, serial data transmission. Okay, then if the bit, that is a B7 bit is equal to 1, serial output data is enabled. So, this is about a bit pattern of a SIM instruction. So, another one, RIM instruction. RIM stands for Read Interrupt Mask. When the instruction is executed, the accumulator is loaded with the bit pattern here, as shown in figure. Okay, RIM is used to examine the status of the pending interrupt, mask, etc. So, after servicing an interrupt request, accumulator content is further processed to service the pending interrupt. So, this is about bit pattern of RIM instruction. Okay, similarly here, B0, B1, B2, these three are masking bits. The next one is interrupt enable. The next one, RST 5.5, interrupt pending, if any pending means, 5.5, if any pending means, here this bit value is equal to 1. Similarly, 6.5, interrupt pending, this is 7.5, interrupt pending. The last one is a serial input data. Okay, then INTR. So, INTR is the lowest priority. So, this is non-vectored interrupt. No-vectored interrupt or non-vectored interrupt. The peripheral device requesting the attention of the microprocessor may provide a hardware-generated RST instruction, or it may provide call instruction to the microprocessor. Okay. So, when the peripheral device requires the service, it sends a high bit to INTR input. Okay, if the interrupt system is enabled and trap on the other RST lines are not high, the microprocessor accepts the INTR request. Immediately, the microprocessor send out interrupt acknowledgement signal INTA to the device. Okay, then the device provides the output for the call instruction. Then the microprocessor send two more INTA signal. At the first INTA signal, the device send the low order address of the service subroutine. Then after that, the second INTA signal, the device send a high order address. Then after that, the content of the program counter is saved in the strand. And then program execution begins from the memory location specified by the call instruction. Okay, so these are the hardware interrupts. Okay, the next one is restart instructions, that is the software interrupts. Already you know 8 software interrupts that are RST0 to RST7. These instructions are single byte call instruction, also called as a software interrupt. RST instructions are used to call frequently used subroutines. So here vector address also we have seen. For example, RST1 instruction will push the content to the PC into the stack. Then the control branches to the address, that is a 0008. The subroutine located from 0008 is executed, then returned to the main program. Usually, the restart location and the next two memory location contain jump address instruction. So, this allows the program to branch to a longer subroutine. So, this is the use of software interrupts, that is restart instructions. So, this is about interrupts of 8085 microprocessor.
We have come to the end of our session on Unit 1.
In Unit 1, we have learnt about hardware architecture, pin details of 8085 microprocessor, functional building blocks of 8085 microprocessor, memory organization, I/O ports, data transfer concept, timing diagram, and interrupts. So, we will see in the next session